Hello, everyone. My name is Special Agent Brian Ford. I work in the paranormal investigation wing of the Angular team. And today I'm here to talk about routing in 11 dimensions. My slides work. All right, so when I started out on this presentation, there was just one question that I wanted to answer. Oh, man. All right, loading. Will it load?
Yeah.
All right, so the one question is Angular actually recovered alien technology? So with that in mind, my next slide has no pictures. Let's consider an email app. Just a second. Got connectivity issues. One sec. Let's reload. There we go. That's much better. All right. Sorry to make you watch me do this. Present with speaker notes. All right, okay. Look at that, there we go. So is Angular actually recovered extraterrestrial technology? All right, so with that in mind, let's consider an email app. You probably have a bunch of different views. You have one like this, that's your inbox. You have another one that's kind of your detail view that shows individual emails. And then maybe you have a search view as well. And this is really kind of a good point to introduce routing basics, right? We just need to switch between different views, update URLs, make sure back forward buttons work as expected. And so if we look kind of at this email client, we have a couple parts on the page that stay the same, and then this part in the middle that changes depending on which route or which page we're on. And we call this part in the middle ng outlet. It's basically the same thing as ng-view in Angular 1, but it's tied to components instead of just a global thing. So this is just a directive in Angular 2 that acts as a placeholder for the different content that you might have depending on your route. So we can visualize routes like this, right? You have this outlet and you have a set of components that are inserted into it depending on the URL. Really, that's all route configuration is. It's this mapping of URL to component. So we distill it down to something like this. We have example.com that shows our index component. We have /email/123 that shows our detail component. And we have /search with some search query, and that shows our search component. And so in the code, it looks like this. So in Angular 2, we represent this with a route config metadata decorator. And this just takes an array of route config objects. So they have a path, and they have a component. Component is just a reference to an Angular component. Path is this kind of matcher DSL language. So if you're familiar with something like Express.js or with ng-route in Angular 1, you have a series of segments that are either kind of static segments, something like just search, or just a single slash or an empty string. We treat things like a single slash and empty string as the same because we normalize all of it. We strip all the leading and trailing slashes, so you don't have to worry about that whole mess. And you have things like /:ID that represent a route parameter, right? So in our example here, we have this email component, and this email component has an ID, and that refers to a specific email in our app, right? And so the way you can get a hold of this is you can inject this route param service. It's just like any other service that you'd inject into Angular 2. And it acts as an immutable map of param names to their string values that get parsed out of the URL. Right, so we've shown all the different things. So now in our app, if you go to example.com, you see the index. And if you go to email 1234, you see this. And if you go to search query equals GitHub Angular, you see something like this. And so far, I guess my explanations are sort of like this explanation of how to draw an owl. routing is sort of the drawing the circles part. I'm not really going to go into how you implement individual components. That's what the rest of the talk at this conference is about. But don't worry, someone else will teach you how to draw the rest of that hole. Okay, so it's kind of silly to have a client-side app and have to refresh the browser to show individual routes. So we have a mechanism for creating links, and let's see how this looks. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to name these routes. We use this property as, and we give them a name. These names are title case, just by convention. And they correspond to the components. So we have index, email, and search corresponding to each of the different views. Right. Then we can go into the component for our application. So this is kind of the top level component. And we can add some code like this. Right. So we have this router link directive. And I'll kind of break apart what all this means. But these link to index and search respectively. All right. So that's a lot. Let's see how we can break this apart. So the first thing is in Angular 2. You represent property bindings with these square braces. And the thing on the right-hand side is the value for it. So in this case, we have just a JavaScript array that happens to contain a single string. And the string is a leading slash. This tells a component router that this is an absolute route. And it has a route name. And we'll revisit what it means to be absolute versus relative and all of this later. But the important thing is that you see the correspondence between the route name and the route configuration here. All right, so let's see how we would construct and like render an actual link here. So we start with this router link directive. We're going to look up on the application components route configuration because this is an absolute route. And we're going to look for a route called index. Because the index has a path that's just a static string slash, we'll put that in as the href and render it. We also set up listeners, so instead of just refreshing the page, we prevent the click and change the components around and update the URL with history push state. So this link DSL mirrors URLs, but it uses route names and route params instead of URL fragments. We recall in our route config, we had a component called email component, and it took this ID parameter. So before, we were just showing how to link to a route without any sort of parameters. But let's see how we would link to email component for a given email with a given ID. One way that we could do this is we could look at our index component. So in our index component, we actually have to generate links to all of these emails. So we can use ng4. This is just another Angular 2 directive. Iterate through emails, which are assumed to be bound on the component here, and set up a router link where we have email, and then we have this map of parameters from ID to email.id. So again, email is something that ng4 gave us, and it has a property ID. So you can use bindings inside the right-hand side of this router link directive. So here's kind of this diagram again. This time, let's show it with the parameters. So we have the route name, and we have this JavaScript array still. And inside of the array, we have a second item that's this JavaScript object that represents the route parameters. So in this case, we give it an ID 123. Again, let's just go through the motions here so we're all on the same page about how we would render this. All right, so again, we look up on app components route configuration, the route named email, and we're going to interpolate 123 into the spot in the path that we gave before. So this link DSL is much more robust, and it survives refactors better than URLs. So you can sort of already see how many places you'd have to change normally in your code if you changed the structure of your URL. But the nice thing is that you would only have to change your route configuration, for instance, if you needed to rename email to something like messages or what have you. So these are kind of the fundamental building blocks of routing. We have the route config metadata, we have the router outlet directive, and we have the router link directive. And once you understand these, you can get into kind of more interesting, complicated use cases. So child routes are one of these such things. So to motivate this, let's say we have a feature in our email client where we display the threaded messages below, and then we also want to be able to click on that giant file icon and see some information about this attached file. Right? So you can sort of imagine that this part on the bottom is just another router outlet. Right? We want to switch between these two views, but still persist the email title and email body. Right, so child routes allow you to sort of encapsulate these different nested structures that you might have while still reusing existing parts of your app. So to add this feature, we would probably refactor our email component. So we want to split it out into two sub-routes, two child routes. So we'll have the thread view and we'll have the file view. And file takes an ID and thread is, it doesn't take anything. It just shows us all the messages there. All right, so here's probably what our email component looked like before. We need to add a route config, here's what our email component looks like. Note that we add a router outlet here, and we have a route config. We'll go back to that in a second. So at the app component level, if you want to have a component that has a child route, you need to specifically denote that using this dot, dot, dot notation. Right? So what this tells the component router is that when you look for email ID, you need to keep going and look at email components route config as well because there's child routes. There's other things that you have to match. So to link to child routes, you do something like this. Right? So before we had the slash and the route name and the route params. We're just going to add another item to this array. So this is the child route name in this case. So this is how you'd get to the threaded view after we refactored add this feature. So the way that this works out is same as before. We construct the child part, and then we look through to the child. And because the path is just a single slash, we don't actually have anything left to do, right? We'll trim off that last slash because we don't leave dangling slashes. Right? If we wanted to link to the file view, we would add another set of route parameters. So notice here that the parent route and the child route each have their own set of parameters. So when we construct a link with the router link directive and we want to render it, first, again, we do the parent. So we get email 123. But then we need to go on and process the email component's route config. We look up the route called file, and we do the interpolation there as well. And then we concatenate these two things together. So child routes have their own parameters, so you don't have to worry about collisions. Note that before we had two things, a parent and a child, both with ID parameters. And because we provide these separately, there's no worries about them colliding. All right, so I promised that we'd talk a little bit about this leading slash. If you're linking just from anywhere in your app, you need to kind of give the whole hierarchy of what components look like from parent to child. But if you're linking just from the email component to its child, right? So if you're linking from email component to file, you probably just want to reuse the existing parent routes information. So what this relative child, this dot slash, means is just use whatever email we're on, pass those parameters along, and use that to construct a link. So this just helps save you some typing. All right, now we can get to the interesting and tricky stuff, the 11-dimensional routing. So let's say we want to get crazy with our email app, and we want to implement something like this compose view. This is a great experience for a user of the app, right? They can navigate kind of separately in the back there between the search and the detail, right? Maybe they have to look up like a flight number or, you know, look up a tracking code to send it to their friend or something. But we also want to have this view in the front, and it might have its own independent routing. And so that's what auxiliary routes let you do. They allow for multiple independent routes to be active at the same time, and you can navigate between them, and again, they're totally independent. Parent and child routes are dependent, right? So if you navigate away from a parent, you also navigate away from all of those children. All right, so kind of the structure of an auxiliary route is that we want to add another outlet, right? So we add a named outlet called draft, And we also add, well, here's what it looks like rather in the code itself, right? So we add draft down there. You probably do some fancy CSS positioning to make sure that the layers are right. And then we add this route. Instead of path, we give it aux. But other than that, it's very similar to our existing thing. Just to kill all of this right now, AUX is pronounced aux, like awkward. We're not going to have a debate about it. This isn't going to be a GIF, JIF thing. to link to it, we're going to use our router link, but we're going to extend it a little bit. So if you see right underneath our new router outlet, we added a link there. Let's break it apart like we did with the other ones. So again, we're going to have this this absolute link. We want to say this is an auxiliary route of the app component, the top level component. And to denote that it's an auxiliary route, we use a JavaScript array. Inside of there, we just give the auxiliary route name, which is draft with a capital D. And that's basically all you have to do. One of the interesting features about the auxiliary routes is that we preserve them in the URL fully. So normally, when you have parent-child routes, you have some amount of slashes for the parent and some amount of slashes for the child. When you have auxiliary routes, we wrap these in parens. And you can actually have as many auxiliary routes as you want, as long as they have unique initial path names for any given component. So we say that all routes in component router are sort of first-class citizens. And what this means for auxiliary routes is that they can have their own child routes, they can have their own auxiliary routes inside of them, they have their own route params, and they have their own history stack even. So they're decoupled in a very interesting and powerful way. So one thing that we could do is we could implement a modal to confirm whether or not you're going to delete this email. And we can just implement this on top as yet another auxiliary route inside of our compose email component, for instance. So you can think of it as a tree of tree of tree of trees, and so on and so forth. And this is what got me thinking. Is Angular recovered alien technology? Who else would be able to think in this many dimensions, right? Was Angular actually just scraped off of like ancient alien tablets, right? Did it come from like a flying saucer wreck? Right? If you enhance, can see Angular. So I did a bunch of research. I went through all of the documents. And what I found was a startling conspiracy that goes all the way to the top. Yeah, I know. So I was getting on the plane. And actually, I was approached by some FBI agents. And they confiscated all of my proof. So I don't have any hard scientific evidence. But I can say for certain that the component router provides, a couple simple things that you combine together in interesting ways. It provides these child and auxiliary routes to handle, innumerable different situations that you might encounter in your application. And this linking DSL really helps you keep dead links from occurring in your app, right? It's very robust. It does a lot of checking for you. And it means that you can safely refactor navigation within your app with confidence. All right, so that's all I have. I ended early because there's lunch now, and I'm very merciful like that. So thank you, everyone.